Today's topic is how computers save data. So to understand this, we first need to take a step back and understand a little bit about what data is and what it means for the analog world around us to be compressed or saved digitally into a computer. We know that a computer has ones and zeros, which, by the way, if you want to learn more about binary or need a refresher, I have a video on that here. But we know that the world is kind of infinite in its complexity, and a computer is not. So we need to translate that infinite world into the discrete computer. We also need to know how to label and represent this data so that we can see it again when we want to, on some kind of output medium from the computer. We can find it again. We're going to talk about compression to explore how we actually make this manageable, not just for our hard disks on our computer, but also so we don't break the internet, because we, as you're doing right now, commonly stream this information over networks. So keeping it small is really, really important. And we're going to talk to that once we've seen exactly how big things get. To kind of break that apart, we need to first talk a little bit about analog and digital and what they really mean. I think there's, at least from my perspective, a lot of years of kind of hype around digital. It's almost a marketing drive that something is good and new because it's digital versus the old, which is analog. And I don't think this is really a fair way to think about it, because one is actually perfect in a sense. Analog is the perfect representation of all of the information that is possibly there. Digital is imperfect in many ways. Digital says we don't have the capacity to represent all of the information, so we're going to pick and choose what information we're going to sample or actually retain. One way to think about this is a clock on the wall, not the digital clock. Let's think about the old analog clock, right? In fact, there was two versions of the old analog clock. You might remember, if you're like me and you grew up in a school where it was like always above the door, you might have seen both of these versions in different classrooms. So the kind of newer version maybe had a digital presence. So the second hand would jump from 1 second to the next. It didn't sweep in a nice curve, it would jump. That's a digital motion. There's a discreteness to that clock. That clock can represent 12 hours, which we know that if it cycles twice, that's one whole day. Within those 12 hours, each hour can represent 60 minutes. And within that 60 minutes, each minute can represent 60 seconds. We have a definitive amount of representations that we can do with that clock. We can get the product of those seconds and minutes and hours and know exactly how much information we need to store every value that we can represent with that clock. Now think about that same clock, but the one where the second hand just kind of lazily sweeps across the seconds at a nice even pace. That is a purely analog clock. There is actually an infinite number of representations every second as that second hand sweeps by. Now, we can choose to measure these in milliseconds and nanoseconds, and we can even keep going and going and going. But the honest truth is, there is no computer in the world. In fact, we can take all of the computers in the entire world, and we could never represent every discrete value that is possible on that analog clock. Because there is technically an infinite number of locations where that second hand can be between any second. So this is the challenge with any data that exists in the world that we want to bring into the computer. We need to decide what level of precision we want to represent it with and how to go about that. So we mentioned this is called data encoding. The act of data encoding, or serializing, is taking this analog world and changing it into these binary digits. Remember that the transistors in our computer act as switches. They're electronic switches that are very fast, and they can represent values of off and on. And we commonly show these as ones and zeros. Now we're going to see how we represent different things with the same ones and zeros, and how we know that thing is, you know, say a text document versus an image. The way that we keep track of what data represents what objects is what's called metadata. There's actually two ways to use metadata. There's metadata, as you might think of it, about how you label your song, right? You might have an MP3 And that has a title, it has an artist, it might have a time and date when it was recorded. That is all metadata about the file. And it's very important because it helps us find the file. But there is also metadata that helps the computer understand how the data is represented. So that same song, for example, might have a rate at which it sampled. How many times per second was the tone of the music actually sampled so that it could be converted into zeros and ones? And then there's also how many zeros and ones did you use to represent any point in time at which you sampled that song? This is also metadata. Another example is representing things graphically with pixels. Pixels are discrete points on the monitor that can display light. And there's a certain amount of different colors that the pixel can represent, decided by how many bits we represent each pixel with. So, for example, if I only used one bit to represent the colors in a pixel, I would only be able to make it either white or black. Or I can actually choose any two colors, but those are kind of the most obvious ones. If I had two bits to represent a single pixel, I could actually represent it four ways. Both bits could be zero. The first bit could be one, the second bit could be one, or both bits could be one. So we could think of this as four colors of our choosing. Perhaps the one and one is white, the one and zero is red, the zero and one is blue, and the zero and zero is black. Now, we could, of course, assign these things arbitrarily, and that's the point. We need to know what the agreed-upon format is. So we need to know how many pixels we have. Maybe we need to know how many bits we use to represent each pixel. This information is also metadata. So combining this information with the actual data, the stream of bits that's serialized from the outside world, this represents the file. We put these two things together and we get a file format, something like a PDF or a Word format, a PNG or a JPEG. These are all different file formats that take raw data and apply metadata so that we know how to interpret that data, and then possibly additional metadata that tell us things about the file. So we do this for many different types of data, but I'm going to focus on the big ones here, the ones that we use the most often. This particular video is going to focus on text, alphanumeric characters. I'm also going to have videos that follow this on images, sound, video, and compression. Let's start by exploring text. We refer to alphanumeric data to incorporate the idea of not just letters, but also numbers and the alphanumeric, but also punctuation and special characters. To represent all of these things with ones and zeros, we need a way to agree to take some number of ones and zeros and use them to represent things. So, for example, I could say I'm going to represent the letter A with a zero, and I'm going to represent the letter B with a one. Well, that's great, and it would only take me one bit to do that, but the problem is I can only represent the letter A and B, and I can't even represent an uppercase versus a lowercase version. I can only represent one or the other. What we need to do is figure out how many bits do we need to adequately represent the characters that we care about. Again, we're taking the infinite world of possibilities and we're deciding how to discretely represent it in a digital fashion. Well, if you go back in time far enough in computer terms of the, say the 1950s, 1960s, 1970s even, memory was very expensive and hard to come by, so we wanted to keep that number as small as possible. The early answer was usually 7 or 8 bits was enough for us to represent most alphanumeric characters. Later that number grew, and we'll explore that with Unicode in a few moments. Let's start out with ASCII. ASCII is still a very, very popular way to encode letters and numbers, mostly because the web and more modern UTF-8 standards also incorporate ASCII within them, and I'll talk more about that in a moment. Now, ASCII was the initial kind of winner of the PC revolution, but it actually wasn't the initial winner of the kind of encoding revolution. We'll talk a little bit more about that when I get to EBCDIC. But ASCII was created by the American National Standards Institute, And what they decided on for early versions was 7 bits. So with 7 bits, we know that we have a range of 128. We can represent from 0 to 127. And that means that, you know, if you think about the alphabet, you have 26 letters, but you have 26 letters uppercase and 26 letters lowercase. But then you also actually want to represent numbers, so you have the digits 0 through 9. We have punctuation characters like quotes and single quotes and exclamation marks and periods. And there's also a small set of European special characters we'd like to get in there too. So when you think about all these things, it's very easy to fill up 128 characters. And in fact, they did so pretty quickly. There was an extended version of ASCII that was 8 bits, so that gave us 256 possibilities. I'll talk more about that in a moment. Let's first take a look at what 7-bit ASCII characters look like in a chart. So this chart here shows us how we represent the different characters with the different actual bits. Across the top here, we have the first 3 bits. And over here on the left-hand side, we have the last 4. So you can think of this as bit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 total. What we're saying here is that if we have all zeros, if all 7 bits are 0, we're representing this null control character. I'm going to talk a little bit more about control characters in a moment. If we want to represent the capital letter A, we're going to need our first bit to be 1, second bit and third bit to be 0, and then we're going to have 4, 5, and 6 be 0, and our 7th bit be a 1. So 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 would represent this capital letter A. If we want a lowercase letter A, we're going to have 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, and that's going to represent our lowercase A. If you look here, this is also known as a correlating sequence, by the way, you can see that all of the letters of the alphabet actually follow each other and increase the actual bit number. So while the letter A here is represented by this first digit here is actually a 64 if we think of our weights in binary, and then we have 1 here, so it's a total of 65 in decimal, if I'm converting this to decimal. If we look here at a capital letter B, we can see that it's one more than that, and it's 66. This one would be 67, 68, etc. This is a correlating sequence. It means that if we want to sort these things, we actually can do that just by looking at the smaller versus the larger binary representations of the numbers. Now, interestingly, though, notice that that is not true of the lowercase, because all of the lower cases start with 1, 1 or 1, 1, 1. So that means that this 64 and 32 here, or 96, goes in front of the A, and then we add this, and that actually makes a lowercase A a 97 in decimal. But if you look at the uppercase B here, we said that was a 66. So you can see that the sorting won't work across upper and lowercase letters. This is something that you've probably experienced and not realized why you were doing it. If you program and you've ever used a two upper or two lower function to ensure that your sorting works correctly, what you're actually doing there is forcing your encoding to pick one or the other so that A's and B's are in fact able to be sorted against each other without worrying about case. So you can see here that a lot of the characters that we use in the Latin alphabet every day are in fact represented. We have things like greater than and less than, curly braces, square braces, caret, etc. Over here, however, these probably look less familiar. These are our control characters. These are characters that were used to either control the flow of a program or action, like halt, or to actually add some kind of markup, like an end of line. So you can see here that we had things like a bell that would actually make a sound when that character was encountered. There was also ways to do LF, which was line feed. You had line feed and carriage return, and you either used one or the other to indicate going to a new line, or a combination of them, depending on your operating system. But these control characters are used for just that. They're used to actually mark up the text and give it more context, or in the case of like a bell, to actually affect an action, like make a sound. Another alphanumeric encoding scheme I want to discuss is EBCDIC. It stands for Extended Binary Coded Decimal Interchange Code, and it was developed by IBM around the same time that ASCII was, but a little bit earlier. This is still found today on IBM mainframes that are also known as System Z. I do want to specify that it is specifically on like the traditional ZOS platform, meaning the actual operating system that is the mainframe operating system. These modern mainframes also do in fact run Linux and other systems that run UTF and ASCII and those kinds of encoding. So I do want to kind of point that out. But back in the 1960s, especially in 70s and 80s, that was not an option. These mainframes only ran EBCDIC. And in fact, for a long time, EBCDIC was the predominant encoding scheme because of this. And as a little bit of an aside, as far as a historical note, IBM was not actually completely tied to EBCDIC as they were promoting their own, so to speak. They actually had employees that were helping to standardize ASCII, which became a more universal standard. But the time it took to certify ASCII made it not ready for the big launch of a new IBM mainframe they had called the System 360. It turned out that this System 360 got very, very popular, and in fact, because of its popularity, kind of became a standard for things going forward. It was not intended for EBCDIC to kind of stick around, but ASCII just wasn't ready when they launched this thing. If it had been, history would have been a little bit different. But that aside, what I want to point out about EBCDIC is, unfortunately, it is not really compatible with ASCII. You can convert from one to the other, but they do not line up. In fact, the correlating sequence of the letters is exactly the opposite of ASCII. So instead of, you know, one is ascending, one is descending. But they still do both have a correlating sequence where you can, in fact, sort between them. Another interesting note about EBCDIC was why it kind of came to be what it was. You might not recognize this thing on the screen right now. This is a punch card. So before there were, you know, large storage devices for magnetic disks and such, often programs would be punched into these cards, and you would have a pile of these cards that would be brought into a card feeder, and there was actually computer operators who would manage feeding these things in, and the computer would actually feed these cards in and read them. Now, these cards were physical objects, and punching holes in them actually would cause them to become weaker. So EBCDIC was actually planned around how often these holes would be near each other. Common letter combinations tried to be avoided as to not introduce common failure points in the card. EBCDIC was actually planned more around the punch card than the standardization that made the most sense just from, you know, the perspective of the letters and how they fell. Interesting but related aside, I do not type on a QWERTY keyboard, which is the standard keyboard here in the United States. I type on one known as Dvorak, and there are other similar type keyboards that are more efficient. QWERTY, which is named so because if you look across the top of your keys, you'll see that the first keys there spell QWERTY, was designed actually in the era of the typewriter. And in that era, typewriters threw keys at a piece of paper that was kind of moving in front of them, and they all had to hit this one spot in the middle. And if certain keys, you know, came out at the same time, they would jam. They would kind of get locked together, and it would, you know, mess up the typist and slow everything down, and possibly, you know, cause additional problems. So QWERTY was actually designed with a similar premise. QWERTY was designed in a way that would cause your typing rhythm to have the keys that were the most likely to kind of go up at the same time, like say like T and H when you're typing the or something like that, to be spaced out in a way where they would be less likely to jam. It was not designed around pure efficiency of what letters do you type the most and, you know, how far do you have to reach. When the electric keyboard was developed, not much farther later, the electric typewriter, this was no longer a problem because there was no longer these keys floating through space that could get jammed up. So a new and better typing solution was developed named Dvorak. And this one actually looked at, you know, the keys under your fingers and what were they? You know, so, you know, maybe all your vowels should be under your left hand and all your major consonants should be under your right. And keys that you barely reach for, like Z, you know, they can be moved off somewhere a little bit harder to reach because you barely reach for them. This was definitely a more efficient format, but it never got widely adopted because typists, which was a profession at the time, were not used to typing on it. And changing your keyboard is, and I can tell you because I've done this, quite possibly one of the most difficult things you will ever do in your life. You will never feel as inept as you will the day you change your keyboard and try to force yourself to type in a different keyboard format. So it just didn't get widely adopted. I actually did it in my very early 20s, right around the time I was graduating with my CS degree, because I was already getting some carpal tunnel, and I just decided, well, you know, I have this whole career path I've chosen for myself. I'm going to be typing for quite a while. Let me give this a go, you know, before I have to have surgery. And just as an aside, for me at least, it did work. It took me a good solid month to even, you know, be able to type an email in under 20 minutes again. But it has helped my carpal tunnel. And, you know, over the years, I definitely do have better typing skills than I did, you know, back with QWERTY all those years ago. But that's a complete aside, but it is related to kind of the origins of EPSIDIC. And I find it interesting because, you know, these were the constraints of the world back then. We had these physical mediums to work around. The last alphanumeric encoding scheme I want to talk about, and it's actually a few of them, is Unicode. Unicode was created as an answer to the inadequacies of ASCII, mostly related to the fact that it was just way too small to represent all kinds of other characters. And, you know, Chinese, Japanese, and Korean obviously don't use the Latin alphabet. They have many, many characters that they'd like to represent, and there was no way to do that with the amount of bits that were possible with ASCII. There was obviously other things that we could fix and bring into the world to make it better too, like emojis. So that is something else that Unicode has brought us. Now, while the most common version of UTF is, especially on the web, UTF-8, which by default is usually 16 bits or 2 bytes, but it actually can go up to 32 bits, and it can actually you know, change in size based upon what you're saving to maximize, you know, the storage space when you're not using the extended characters, or when you are using the extended characters to give you the ability to. But there's lots of versions of UTF. The important ones are really UTF-8, which is kind of the standard on the web. There's UTF-16, which has been used for a long time in programming languages like Java and JavaScript and some operating systems. Now, UTF-16 does not have backwards compatibility with ASCII. However, UTF-8 does, so that's why UTF-8 is used so predominantly on the web. And different UTF schemes, you know, have different integration with ASCII, but essentially for UTF-8, those first 8 bits, you know, in the low order, those would represent the same exact things as they did in ASCII. And then your next 8 bits, and possibly past that if it was, you know, beyond a 16-bit UTF-8 number, they would help give you the range to represent, you know, all kinds of other things. You would divide these things up into planes, so they have different planes to represent things like, you know, the Eastern languages and emojis and all this other stuff. I'm not going to go very deep into that. This isn't like an in-depth how to, you know, understand every aspect of UTF-8 video or any UTF, but I just want you to know that that's kind of the basics and it's out there. There's also UTF-32. This always uses a 32-bit code to represent everything. Now, the reason why it does that is speed, because when you have a variable amount like you do in UTF-8, there's a little bit of overhead in understanding what is the size that you're using, so it slows things down a little bit, but you sacrifice the storage because you're using UTF-8/32, even if you're representing something like the number 1 or the letter A, that wouldn't necessarily need all 32 bits to represent it. A fun thing to end on here is just now that we know exactly how UTF and just in general how character encoding works, we can take a standard like UTF-16 in this example and use it to understand why file sizes are the size they are, like how it got to that number. I like UTF-16 because it's usually consistent, so that's why I'm using it here, unlike UTF-8, which can vary. So if we take like a 1 kilobit file, right, a 1,000 byte file, we can infer, because each character is stored in 2 bytes in UTF-16, that we actually can just kind of like half that and get an approximation of how many characters are in the file, which in this case is 500. So throughout this video, I've used the following references. I'm also going to have them down in the comments too. So if you want to read and learn more, please do check these out. Thank you for watching. If this is the first time you're seeing one of my videos, please consider stopping by my channel and subscribing. We have lots of topics in computer science, from computer organization and architecture, which is how computers are built, to robotics, to enterprise mobile, to how to program from a basic level on up, and many, many more. So thank you for stopping by, and I hope you have a great day.